some questions. I'm starting to worry. Surely there must be a question.
If Cyril Pons had lined up early for one of the performances at the Roadhouse, which one would it have been?
Ooh. Well, Cyril's kind of old school. So I'm guessing he would have showed up for Eddie. Yes?
I just wonder if you still get excited the day your book comes out.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it only happens once every 2 years or so. So yeah, it's lonely writing books, so it's nice to see people. Yes?
Are the missing pages of the diary in there?
Can I get back to him? I don't see them right off the bat, but you know, it might just knock them in. Yes.
If you could travel back in time to any time or place, what would it be?
Hitler's delivery room? Ford's Theater? You know, it would be one of those. Where one person could make a difference. But as we know, if you meddle with time, screwy things can happen.
Yes, all the way in the back.
From script to screen, what would
you
like to see
the
film change? From script to screen, how did you feel about episode 8? And what would that look like?
Fantastic.
What's that look in script?
It was about 12 to 15 pages, as I remember. And as we were writing it, David would... David is unbelievable in many ways. His ability to visualize things is like nobody else on earth. And we started, I did the typing, and he started talking about the cloud that was going to be formed by the atomic blast. And it was probably, you know, at most a half a page, I think, just the one paragraph. And I, when I finished typing it, I said, well, that's about 8 minutes. And he said, no, buddy, that's closer to 20. True story. I mean, can't say enough good things about episode 8. Yes.
So you talk a lot about Jefferson and get really deep into the history of the first book that you wrote.
Yeah.
So is that a passion of yours?
Yes.
And then the UFO stuff is so accurate, it's such a thrill to read, knowing all those stories beforehand.
Big history buff.
Yes.
Which is why it's so hard to answer the question of where I would go back to, because there's so many places.
So what was your process then, since you interwove so much fiction into factual accounts of history, where did you kind of go with that?
How do you know it's fiction? It was a weird process. It was trying to find a blend of plausibility and obviously, you know, fabulizing on things like these people in the past being involved with what went on there. But it was a book I'd wanted to write since 1992. I wanted to write the history of the region and build in all these things that may have given us some signs that there were strange things going on there. Don't even get me started on Bigfoot. I mean, he didn't make the cut. There's a lot of strange things up in those woods. Yes?
If David Bowie had appeared in the new series himself, how would he have appeared? Would he have been like white-suited David Bowie from around 1990, or would you have given him a new image creation?
Well, that's really a David question. I mean, we wrote it with him in mind, they had a conversation, and Mr. Bowie let David know he would not be able to participate, and you know, David went from there. So, I mean, I remember what we wrote. You know, that was it was a different look, but I thought it was fantastic. So. And I have a feeling Mr. Bowie would have approved. Well, let me get my Ouija board.
Yeah. Well, I mean, what his look would have been.
Oh, no, I can't tell you. Sorry. Sworn to secrecy. All the way in the back.
Hi,
these two things. David had complete creative control on the series, and I had control on the books, and we shook hands on, and that's how we proceeded.
One other brief one. When did you two decide, and whether it was 25 years ago or to this, that it would be okay to have, like, you pick up glimmers of people in the middle of a story, but not at the beginning, not at the end, never see them again?
You mean in the new series?
In the new series. I mean, the Roadhouse conversations are the most obvious example.
Yeah. Well, the analogy that came to my mind as I was watching the series was, this wasn't unlike Lewis and Clark exploring the Missouri. You know, you went up a lot of different streams and tributaries, and you didn't necessarily stay put for very long and wait to see what happened, but you got a glimpse, and out of that glimpse you could learn many things. And I think it gave a real sense of life being lived beyond the edges of the screen, which was something I really liked about the series a lot, that everything wasn't tied up with a bow, and it gives you stuff to think about, you know, repeated viewings, including the DVD, which will be out on December 4th.
Thank you.
Two
more part-time
projects.
Okay,
right here.
Me?
Yes.
Oh, yay! Okay, I'm Jennifer Lawrence. I'm in like half the
And when episodes 17 and 18 aired, there was a lot of negativity about number 18 and how it kind of went off on this other tangent. Is there anything you could say about that?
No, I didn't agree with it. I thought that it, I mean, raise your hand if you like the end of The Sopranos. Did you like it right away? Or did it take some time? I mean, I liked it at the moment. I love the ending here, too. I liked it for its lack of specificity or finality or tying it with a bow.
It was open-ended, so...
Yeah. You know, that's how we roll. one more?
One more.
You pick. I don't want to get in trouble.
Did you actually design the last two episodes to be played simultaneously?
I think that was more a discussion with Showtime. I mean, what?
No, I mean to actually be played at the same time, like press play on both.
Oh, no. I mean maybe David did, I don't know. That would be crazy. I mean, this is coming from a guy who played Sergeant Pepper backwards, so I can hear Paul is dead. You know, I mean, I'm into that stuff. But and I've heard that if you, is it The Wizard of Oz and
yeah.
The Wall?
Yeah, Dark Side of the Moon.
Dark Side of the Moon. Okay, I've never done that either. But now, hook up The Wizard of Oz with 17 and 18 in season 2. Cross pollinate. All right, time for a costume contest.